welcome to this edition of the SIFMA Podcast. I am your guest host, Katie Kolchin, Head of SIFMA Research. We recently published our 2023 Mid-Year Economic Survey, where we ask our Economist Roundtable to provide their best assessment of the current economic environment and potential monetary policy actions. Our Economist Roundtable estimated 2023 GDP growth at plus 0.5%, followed by plus 1.7% for 2024. 92.3% of economists expect a long-term potential GDP growth rate of 1.5 to 2.0%, with 100% of respondents stating that this is unchanged over the last 12 months. The main factors impacting economic growth were identified as, for 2023, inflation, tight labor market, regional bank turmoil with the credit tightening, U.S. monetary policy. For 2024, U.S. monetary policy comes to the top, followed by U.S. consumer spending, recession threat, and tight labor market. Monetary policy, fiscal spending, economic reopening post-COVID, supply chain disruptions, a war. That was already a lot for an economy to digest. Then we added on the regional bank turmoil and the debt ceiling debate, which is, of course, now resolved. It is no wonder the economy and inflation are where they stand today. In this survey, we analyzed inflation, drivers and expectations for the path back down to the Fed's 2% target, and the economy, in particular, the labor market and the consumer, as well as recession expectations. The report also includes a pictorial view of the Fed's monetary policy conundrum. Continue hiking? Pause to assess the monetary policy lag and other factors like credit tightening? When to begin the pivot, i.e. rate cuts? The Fed has repeatedly stated that it will be data dependent. Unfortunately, the tone of the data is continuously changing and can even send opposing signals on the same day. See the May jobs report. With the data all over the map, so must be the Fed when analyzing its next move. Today, I will highlight for you the top 10 results from our survey. After that, we'll share a conversation between our president and CEO, Ken Bentsen, and the chair of our Economist Roundtable, Dr. Lindsey Piegza, chief U.S. economist for Stifel. Let's get into our top 10, starting with the economy, inflation, labor market, and recession. Number one. 83.3% of respondents believe price pressures are on the way back down, with PCE estimated to end 2023 at plus 3.8% year over year, and then end 2024 at plus 2.6%. It was 4.4% as is April. But disinflation momentum is expected to slow, with 50% responding inflation will not reach the Fed's preferred 2% target until 2H24. That said, 50% of respondents do believe the Fed would tolerate a 2 to 2.5 range instead of exactly on the 2. Number two, economists rank the components impacting the aggregate inflation rate in order: demand, labor component, and then the supply side. The factors listed as most important to core inflation forecasts included consumer spending on services, stickiness of wage increases, historically hot labor market, and monetary policy. Number three, 81.8% of respondents believe we are not in a wage price spiral, with wages plus 4.3% in May versus plus 5.5% a year ago. 91.7% of respondents believe we have reached a peak in wage pressures. 70.0% of respondents expect growth to return to the historical 3% level by 2024. Number four, 50% of respondents believe the U3 unemployment rate needs to increase to 4 to 4.5% to meaningfully impact inflation, with 58.3% of respondents expecting to reach this target rate by 2024. Number five, none of the respondents believe the U.S. is already in a recession, while 69.2% of respondents believe the U.S. will enter a recession. Moving on to monetary policy, the Fed rate actions. Number six, our Economist Roundtable expects the peak Fed funds rate to be 500 to 550 basis points to be achieved by 2Q23. This was responded by 78.6% of respondents for each answer. And we'd like to note that we were already at this level with the Fed funds rate standing at 5 to 5.25%. Number seven, monetary policy comes with a lag time before working its way into the economy. 38.5% of respondents believe this lag time is 9 to 12 months. As such, 92.3% of respondents think the Fed should pause and assess the impact of earlier rate hikes, with 91.7% of respondents expecting this pause to take place in 2Q23. Number eight, as to when the Fed will pivot and begin cutting rates, 71.4% responded 1Q24, with 76.9% of respondents believing it will take over 100 basis points of cuts before stabilizing. Number nine, 67.7% of respondents estimate the corresponding credit tightening post the regional bank turmoil is equivalent to 50 basis points of additional Fed rate hikes. This would put the implied Fed funds rate at 5.5 to 5.75% at or greater than the expected peak rate mentioned earlier. And number 10, as to whether the credit tightening should be a factor in the Fed's decision-making for further rate actions, 91% of respondents noted both that it should be and that it is and will be. Those are our top 10. You can download the full survey report at www.sifma.org/research. And with that, it is my pleasure to bring you this conversation between Ken and Lindsey, where they will dig into more details from the survey.
Well, thank you, Katie, and thank you, Lindsey, for being with us today. Lindsey, let's get right into it. I mean, the Fed, obviously, in the comments from the chair and various members of the FOMC and governors remains committed to its inflation fight. As such, this is probably the most important factor in their policy decisions. Maybe we could begin with you discussing what your thoughts are on the inflation picture. Where are we now and where are we going to be at the end of the year?
Absolutely. Great question to start with. And let me begin by saying thank you for having me, Ken. But the inflation picture right now is very complicated. Price pressures are proving to be much more sticky as of late, by which I mean the Fed had anticipated that we would have seen much more improvement by this point. And while I will concede that we're off earlier peak levels, no matter which way you slice it, inflation, headline or core, which excludes food and energy costs, remains more than double the Fed's preferred 2% target, with little indications, I think at this point, of a discernible downward trend, meaning we're still seeing that lack of disinflationary momentum. And in fact, if you break out some of the subcomponents of the inflation calculation, housing, for example, remains at a new high of over 8%. So here, we haven't yet peaked, let alone seen the expected improvement. And in fact, as we've heard recently, according to Fed Governor Michelle Bowman, still elevated housing costs specifically, could impact the Fed's ability to lower inflation and reach the committee's 2% target. Or even when we isolate core services, excluding housing, which many see as a proxy for that wage price spiral that the Fed so fears, here prices remain at roughly 5%. So again, there is little evidence that inflation is on a sustainable downward pathway, at least not yet. Now, that's not to say that we won't continue to see improvement, albeit painfully slow, but at this pace, we could remain between 3.5 to 4% still by year end, perpetuating the need for further action by the Fed.
Well, and related to that, I mean, obviously the Fed, through its multiple rate hikes, almost unprecedented over the period of time, has been trying to slow demand, try and temper the economy as a whole, put the brakes on growth in the labor markets in order to cool inflationary pressures. Not quite clear that's happening yet. How do you see the economy at this point in time and the labor market and the health of the consumer?
Well, that's just it. The American consumer, and by extension then the U.S. economy, remains quite resilient, increasingly willing to draw down savings. There's been a last sputtering of state and local stimulus, and consumers have increasingly turned to credit cards and other sources of debt to supplement their spending, this still positive, albeit reduced, level of spending. Now, on the consumer front, typically, this is somewhat of a red flag for the consumer when credit card balances begin to surge. But during the pandemic, households weren't just buying Pelotons. They were actually paying down debt, which is to say that we're now beginning from a position of relative strength. Or maybe at the very least, it's clear that the consumer has some additional runway to accumulate further debt before it becomes that traditional or historical red flag of increasing fragility on part of the consumer. But while these temporary supports, I think, will eventually prove to be just that, temporary, for now, the consumer has proven to be, as I mentioned, surprisingly resilient, continuing to support economic growth at these reduced but still positive levels. In fact, if we look at GDP, much of the weakness at the start of the year was the result of an arguably overly pessimistic corporate America, cutting back production and drawing down inventories in anticipation of a more discernible slowdown in spending. So going forward, as we await those Q2 GDP numbers, it's likely to show an increased level of strength relative to the first quarter, as producers are now forced to restock those depleted inventories. But longer term, I would say, as the consumer loses momentum, continues to lose momentum, and the Fed presumably continues to raise rates in its fight against inflation, intentionally tapping down investment, intentionally tapping down consumption, the economy will slow. But as we saw in the survey data, most have pushed out that anticipation of substantial weakness to the end of the year or even early 2024. Most still anticipate that weakness to eventually come to fruition, but the timeline has certainly been extended. And as a result, that stronger than expected consumer base, that stronger than expected performance on part of the labor market, with still hundreds of thousands of jobs being created on a monthly basis, not to mention even at the most recent 3.7%, we're bouncing along that multi-decade low. So again, that expectation for this weakness to set in, this weakness to come to fruition, this has been extended as a result of that stronger than expected labor market performance and consumer base, which of course is the backbone to the U.S. economy.
Since the last time we did the prior survey, we've had the situation and some stress in the regional bank market. And obviously, beyond the failures of a few banks, obviously credit tightening that's gone on. There's been other data showing some uptick in the consumer delinquencies as well. What do we think about credit tightening and what the impact of that is, particularly supplemental to the Fed rate hikes? Is that a rate hike in and of itself?
Well, it's certainly a key component of the Fed's overall policy plan, or the total level of policy firming needed to tame inflation. Now, we've long contended that the total level of tightening would need to represent roughly 600 basis points in order to sufficiently slow demand, and by extension, then the broader economy, and of course, then by extension, result in price relaxation. But should an organic change in credit conditions do some of the Fed's work for it, the committee may not need to raise the target level as high as 6%. So in other words, if tighter credit conditions do 50 basis points or 75 basis points of the Fed's work, then the committee may not need to raise rates quite as high. They may only need to raise rates one or two more times this year, as total policy adjustments or total policy firming includes now both further rate hikes as well as that organic adjustment to credit conditions implemented directly onto the market via financial institutions. Now, looking at the Fed's latest survey data, it is clear that a rising number of institutions have reported they are tightening credit conditions relative to Q1 of last year. However, when we look at the differential between Q1 and Q2 of 2023, meaning this year, the differential is very minimal. So even in the aftermath of the most recent volatility, in the aftermath of SVB and First Republic, we don't see the crisis level response that I think many Fed members and some market participants had anticipated. So again, while the Fed is taking that into account when they're looking at their total recommendation for policy firming, right now, it doesn't seem to be making a discernible dent in the need for further tightening in terms of traditional or more organic rate hikes.
And, you know, if we think about, you know, that, you know, taking it one step further, we got the FOMC meeting next week. What do you think is going to happen next week? Obviously, 93% of you and your colleagues in our survey believe that, 93, I think it's right, believe that, they're going to pause. But, you know, how do you see that rolling out if that's correct? What happens after that pause? Do they, you know, when do they, particularly given your comments that you don't see, inflation dropping below a 3% handle by the end of the year. How do you see the Fed pivoting, either pause or no pause, pivoting through the rest of the year?
Well, let me start with this. As we just talked about with credit conditions, this is part of the motivation for the Fed to potentially move to the sidelines, to pause and assess the impact of changing credit conditions, changing financial conditions, as well as assess the full impact of earlier policy initiatives. We're talking about 500 basis points of tightening. As most assume, there still is a sizable and variable lag in terms of the full effects of monetary policy filtering into the real economy. So the Fed has indicated a willingness to pause and will likely do so this month. But I think, to be clear, as we talked about through some of the data, particularly in the inflation data, the data do not support the need for a pause or a skip as of yet. So any decision to do so from the Fed would not be made because of the data, but really in spite of the data. Now, the Fed is aware of, again, as we talked about, market fragility and the sensitivity to further tightening, but with the labor market seemingly at full employment, the focus for the committee remains on inflation. As we talked about, we have not seen that clear downward momentum in inflation. So even those Fed members that have largely supported a pause, Jefferson, Harker, they're supporting that pause sooner than later. Even these Fed members have clarified that this would be a temporary stay in rate hikes, and this would in no way indicate an end to tightening. Again, a one-off pause that would simply allow Fed officials to fully assess the economic impact of earlier tightening, but in no way does this indicate that rate hikes are finished. We do expect the Fed to slow the pace of rate hikes this quarter, taking in every other meeting approach, meaning pause, or maybe better classified as a skip, re-engage, potential another skip, re-engage, followed by potentially an ongoing pattern of skip and re-engage, bringing eventually the Fed funds rate up just shy of 6% by the end of the year. And we do suspect that they will maintain this level of elevated funds well into 2024 should inflation remain elevated, despite the market's expectation for a series of rate cuts beginning potentially in Q3. Once reaching that terminal level, it's going to be difficult for the Fed to not necessarily justify tightening beyond that sufficiently restrictive level, but if we do not see inflation meaningfully decline, meaningfully retract, the Fed will be forced to keep rates at that elevated level for much longer than the market's expecting. So essentially a higher for longer scenario.
Good way to end, Lindsey. Thank you. So if I just summarize what you said, just like the data is continuously changing and the Fed continues to say it is data dependent, it sounds like we're going to be continually changing between our pause or skip and some hikes, perhaps slower rate of hikes, as you said. I will say thank you to Lindsey and Ken, and thank you to everyone for joining us today. And we encourage everyone to go to www.sifma.org/research to read the full survey report. Thank you.